A very good afternoon, everyone. On behalf of the Institute of Management, Nirma University, I, Ritika Atal, extend a warm welcome to all of you in the CEO lecture series, which is a part of the Silver Jubilee celebration of IMNU. Seeking blessings from the Almighty is the best way to begin any earnest endeavor. I would now request Ms. Anyora to recite the Saraswati Vandana.
Thank you, Ritika. या कुंदेन्दु तुषार हार धवला या शुभ्र वस्त्रावृता या वीणावर दंड मंडित करा या श्वेत पद्मासना या ब्रह्मच्युत शंकर प्रभति भृदेवे सदा वंदिता सामा पातु सरस्वती भगवती निशेष जाड्यापहा। थैंक यू रितिका।
थैंक यू। We are extremely privileged to have with us our keynote speaker for the session, Mr. Bhupendra Suri, CEO of Creamline Dairy Private Limited. We are also honored to have with us today Dr. Anoop Singh, Director General, Nirma University, Dr. Suvir Verma, Director, Institute of Management, Nirma University. We welcome all the dignitaries. Now, let us have a glimpse of Nirma University.
A university is a knowledge enterprise that contributes to social, political, economic and scientific development of nations and society. And we at Nirma University, with our Honorable President Dr. Karsanbhai Patel's vision to contribute to the development of the society, strive to build a strong foundation for our country's bright tomorrow.
Nirma University is committed to contribute to the society by providing its students relevant knowledge and skills, engaging the learning environment and state-of-art facilities. Our vision is shaping a better future for mankind and developing effective, socially responsible individuals and organizations.
Our academic and administrative systems work toward ensuring the achievement of our mission. We are committed to put Nirma University on a world map.
These leaders would develop a better future for mankind so that all of us prosper. Nirma University is also developing as a research university, and it does cutting-edge research and innovation.
Nirma University was established in the year 2003 and has gradually, over the years, earned the stature of one of the most prestigious universities in India. What started as an initiative of Nirma Education and Research Foundation in the year 1994 went on to expand into being Gujarat's first self-financing engineering institute in 1995 and autonomous Nirma Institute of Management in 1996. Contribution towards excellence in higher education led to the birth of Nirma University in the year 2003 through a legislative process, and it became the first private university in the state of Gujarat. Nirma University then went on to create a Faculty of Doctoral Studies and Research in 2004 to promote doctoral education, contributing over 350 PhD graduates till date. Over the years, we have developed programs in the fields of technology, management, pharmacy, science, law, architecture and planning, commerce and design. Nirma University is recognized by the University Grants Commission under Section 2F of the UGC Act. The university was awarded an A grade in 2015 by National Assessment and Accreditation Council. The Institute of Management imparts world-class business education. It has emerged as a national business school and has played a vital role in producing new generation of leaders over a period of 2 decades.
At the Institute of Management, Nirma University, students are trained to take informed decisions and drive organizations towards their goals.
It offers various programs in the area of business administration.
Institute of Management, Nirma University has provided us with various opportunities for personal learning.
The professors at Nirma University are our pride. Besides imparting high-quality instruction, they play the role of a guide, friend, and mentor to all those who study under them.
Our recent adoption of outcome-based education has added a lot of value to we as a faculty as well as to our students.
The 110-acre sprawling state-of-the-art campus provides refreshing environment and stimulates intellectual growth and creativity. The university campus has a serene academic ambience that motivates the students to focus on development and all-round growth. The university is a community perpetually in motion, with the students running clubs, planning and executing national and international activities, competitions, annual, technical and cultural festivals and life projects. Nirma University is equally committed to the employability and employment of the students. All the institutes of the university have active placement cells that train the students for jobs and organize placement activities in reputed companies. Nirma University is closely networked with its different stakeholders. For example, it has, among others, active MOUs with ISRO, IPR and PRL for research. It has MOUs with a host of universities in the different parts of the globe for student and faculty exchange and joint research. Its students are absorbed by companies like Goldman Sachs, JP Morgan, Accenture, HUL, Amazon, Novartis, etc. The central goal that Nirma University stands for is to provide a stellar education and lifelong learning skills and the means to do so effectively to all its students. The university strives to bring about a positive transformation in the lives of its students and enables them to become independent, confident, and self-sufficient citizens.
Thank you for playing the video. We have with us today Dr. Subir Verma, Director, Institute of Management, Nirma University, Professor Subir Verma, did his PhD from IIM Ahmedabad and is an MA Gold Medalist and MPhil from Delhi University. Professor Verma has been the recipient of Dr. Karan Singh Gold Medal, Professor C.J. Chacko Merit Certificate, UGC Junior and Senior Research Fellowship, AICTE Award for Travel to South Africa and Club International Award for Research and Training Teaching in France. I would request Professor Verma to deliver a welcome address.
Thank you, Ritika. Let me begin with welcoming Dr. Bhupinder Suri, Mr. Bhupinder Suri, on behalf of the Institute, and also on behalf of our Vice Chancellor, of our DG, Vice Chancellor Dr. Anoop Singh, who was earlier the director also of the Institute of Management. So I'm carrying forward that legacy of inviting luminaries like Mr. Suri to the campus and addressing our students. Mr. Suri, you will be glad to know that we have this is the silver jubilee of the Institute. We started with 1996, and as of now, we would be having around 1,500 odd students. I would say between 1,540 students, around 1,540 students, spread across 5 programs. One is the MBA general program that we have. Another is the MBA in HR. Then we have an integrated BBA and MBA program. Then we have a family business and entrepreneurship program. And finally, we have the BTech MBA program. So we are actually straddling the entire gamut of graduates who can come in from different streams. And therefore, we have a tremendous diversity in terms of our intake. Around more than 50% of my students are from commerce, and in terms of our gender diversity, we have more around 40 to 45% of them. So so hugely diverse campus, and both in terms of the educational background, in terms of the regional background, the language, the linguistic background, and we and basically in the IMNU we say we are celebrating India. So welcome to this India, that microcosm that we have over here, and I let me at the outset also thank you for agreeing to give a talk to our students at such a short notice. I know that I have taken advantage of our friendship, but I do hope that you will forgive me for this, and I can count on you for further blessings. So Mr. Suri, welcome to you on behalf of the Institute of Management in Rye University.
Thank you very much. Thanks a lot.
Thank you, sir. We also have with us Dr. Anoop Singh, Director General of Nirma University. Professor Anoop K. Singh is an eminent academician and thought leader. Under his leadership, since 2013, Nirma University has moved from strength to strength. He did his PhD from the University of Allahabad and postdoctoral fellowship from the University of Michigan, Ann Arbor. He was a visiting scholar at the J.L. Kellogg Graduate School of Business Administration. He has many publications to his credit, comprising books, research papers in international and national journals, case studies, book chapters, in addition to paper presentations at national and international levels. He is a recipient of various awards for teaching excellence. We welcome you, sir, and request you to address the audience.
Thank you. I also take this opportunity to welcome Mr. Suri. I know that a senior person like him does not have one thing easily available, and that is time. So when you give time to someone, any institution, that shows your commitment to the student community, and we at Nirma University are very, very thankful to you, sir. Our dear students, I'll just take few minutes to talk to you. I know that you are looking forward to listening to Mr. Suri, and his background is such, his topic is such, that everybody would like to listen to him, because most of you are interested in marketing, and he would share some mantras of marketing. For me, marketing is the simple art of converting commodity into products and products into brands. So one can say that in one sentence, but the journey is so arduous and so challenging, and he's going to share some of those mantras with you. When we started the business journey after independence in this country, we had a meager infrastructure. We had almost commodities. We didn't have even products, right? And everything was based on one competitive factor, and that was cost. Whether my commodity is cheaper or your commodity is cheaper, so whosoever was having cheaper commodity was more successful. And of course, we had a very regulated environment, and there was not much scope. So the basic factor of competition was cost. And by the time, you know, we covered another 3 decades, we started moving towards quality, right? And those companies which were managing their cost but producing better quality, they were doing better there than their competition, right? However, quality was also not sufficient. And the third factor came, and that was customization. How do you understand your customer? And how do you customize your products as per the needs of the customer? And that continued for another 2 decades. And as we moved into 21st century, another factor of competition was added, and that was the speed, right? how fast you can reach your customer and how much time you are taking for that. So from cost to quality to customization to speed. And another factor came, and that was innovation, right? How do you innovate? How do you come out with the new offerings? How do you come out with new processes? How do you come out with new ideas? So another factor was added, and lo and behold, then we got something known as the Industry 4.0, and that changed the whole game. So all these factors remain important, but then they are taken for granted. And a new set of factors of competitions are increasing. For example, how do we develop an organization which is information based? How fast we are able to understand the needs and aspirations of the customers? How fast we are able to integrate with our distributors? How fast we are able to understand the mindset of our customers as well as suppliers? So we are in a very different game. And I know when you must have read Flip Kotler, right? The first chapter would have been Pepsi versus Cola, right? But probably the new chapter where he would talk about Industry 4.0, he would talk about Microsoft versus Google. So the world has changed. So there are certain truths which remain, but new truths are emerging, and you need to learn about them. And Mr. Suri is one person who has seen it all, right? He has seen those days where cost was important, quality was important. But today he is also seeing a world where people are much more informed and where supply chain has become much more competitive. So he would be able to give you a very fine framework to understand the business scenario. And in that business scenario, how young budding managers can cope with it and contribute to organization. I'm sure that you would be able to have some guru mantras from him. So once again, welcome, Mr. Suri. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Taking the session forward, it gives me immense pleasure to welcome our distinguished speaker for today's session, Mr. Bhupendra Suri. Mr. Bhupendra is the CEO of Creamline Dairy Private Limited. His prolific career spans nearly three decades, of which 23 years were with Coca-Cola, where he performed various roles in sales, distribution, supply chain, RTM, and franchise bottling operations. He led Coca-Cola's national franchise bottling operations business in India. He was the managing director of Coca-Cola Nigeria till 2019. His last stint was as CEO for Divyani Food Industries Limited, where he was responsible for running the Creamwell ice cream business in India. He has also worked with Bajaj Auto Limited and Asian Paints Limited. Mr. Bhupendra did his BTech from IIT Varanasi and completed his PGDM from XLRI Jamshedpur. Sir is an avid reader and a published author of two books. We are extremely honored to have you, sir. Without much ado, now I would request Mr. Bhupendra to share his valuable insights with us.
Thank you. Thanks a lot for the introduction. And thank you very much, Dr. Anoop and Dr. Subir, of helping me kick off this session and put the setting. For the students, I was already talking to Dr. Subir just before this, and I was saying that I'm always pretty happy and very pleased when I'm with the young people. You know, many years in industry and too many older people in the organization sometimes dulls you. And it is always good to sit in a group like this. And I'm sure as I will finish some part of my talk and I will open it up for question and answers, I will get some questions. And I've always found that these questions always get me thinking. I mean, they make me see stuff which probably I have not seen or thought about. Because all of you bring a lot of different perspectives to the room and a different time frame, and you are so young, you see the world in a different way. like Dr. Anoop was saying, we saw a time when cost was the dominant factor and availability used to be the big story. You know, the big story in the business world was availability. If you can get your stock available, that was good enough. That was great enough. I mean, you really were doing very well. And now all that has changed. You know, everything is available. I'm sure you guys have seen over last at least 2 years of COVID where, you know, just clicking on the button and everything arrives at your house without even thinking about it. And look at the competition it generates for those companies who dependent on distribution as their main structure, that I can make stuff available for you. So life is changing very, very fast. And I would echo that. A little bit on myself, the compare, she, you know, explained where I've been, but I'll just give you a perspective and that'll bring me to the talk, what I'm going to give today, which is from commodity to brands. This is probably the most important and critical journey. And that's why you are sitting in the Nirma Institute, to learn, to be creative, to learn the skills required to help companies to move from this commodity mindsets to the brand mindsets. And however simple it may sound, let me tell you, it's always a big grind to create a brand and to make a brand launch from a scratch is a massive task. And I have done it multiple times and, you know, many times failed and many times succeeded. But it is a very slow and arduous process to win the mind of the consumer, to really enter the mind of the consumer and be there. It's a and you know, things which you don't expect to work out well will suddenly work out well, and things which you expected were a sure shot win will tend to just fly past and you don't know what happened. So those are things, that the realities of the business and the market. And my career, I was with consumer durables, with Bajaj and Asian Paints, you know, paints and scooters, as you can imagine. And from there to Coca-Cola, which is a very fast moving FMC product, which you all know, highly competitive. And Dr. Anoop also talked about the famous Coke and Pepsi wars, which has been a standard, you know, parlance in marketing on how to go about the market in a most aggressive fashion. And then the last two stints after I spent 23 years with Coca-Cola was with, again, in food industry with ice cream, and now with a business which has got milk, and with milk it is, we've got a lot of value-added products. So we have milk, curd, ghee, butter, cooking butter largely. Then we have milk drinks, badam milk drinks, and thick shakes, and multiple other such sweets. We have a lot of sweets. So we have a range of products which get created through milk, which uses milk as some base or some part of milk. And this is where we first time came in contact with a large commodity business. To give you a size and scale of this business, the way we operate, we are largely in southern part of India. The name of our brand is Godrej. It's a Godrej company, Godrej Jersey. And that brand has been a sizable footprint in Hyderabad, Andhra, and Telangana, and also a footprint which came in a little later in Tamil Nadu and Karnataka, as well as some part of Maharashtra, closer to Hyderabad. So that's where we are, with obviously a vision to grow beyond these borders. But the milk business is very intense. There are certain categories which are well entrenched. I mean, I you know, like they say, you don't need to tell anybody that how to have milk or should have milk. There are categories where you have to explain to consumer. Here, the category is well established, well settled. So it is a red ocean of sorts, where there is a battle of who gets the milk consumer, who gets the milk consumer. And then there is all these value-added products, where definitely there is a play to make it a bigger brand and to grow the brands. And we have been playing a lot in that zone. Because the only issue with the commodity is it does not give you any pricing ability. You know, one way to look at it is the whole structure is driven on cost, which is one way to look at it. The other way of looking at it is you cannot get any pricing ability. So if I go to the market, if I increase the price by somewhat, I will lose a lot of volume. So I have to stick to the pricing, which is competitive with everybody else. And the whole work is to climb out of this sort of a deep well, where if you can take a little higher price, then the consumer does not leave you. That is the big job all the time. And whenever you say, okay, I give you a better quality, or I will, you know, give you a better benefit, which you will, you know, value and be ready to pay for, you know, with vitamins, with whatever, and you're ready to pay for it. Interesting, the Indian consumer is very, very cost effective, in the sense, very calculative. So they won't buy any value easily. They have to be given that value for which they will pay their extra money. Otherwise, nobody's paying you money. And that leads to a very low margin business, but it is driven on high volume. So when I do a lot of value added products in Creamline Dairy, one thing important to remember is that the milk business is very important for me, which is a, like a commodity business, because that gives the scale. So we have 1.5 lakh liter farmers, which we deal with, 1.5 lakh spread across the whole of southern part of India. So we get milk from them. That milk is brought to some 100 chilling centers, which is then brought to some 10 plants, then converted into the milk pouches, which you get in the morning. And that all happens within one day. So day one morning, if the cow or the buffalo give milk, then by day two, I have to get it to your house. So, and it happens across the whole southern region, and about more than 6 lakh liters of milk flows in. And because this is a huge commodity and with a low margin, so the commodities always will give you low margin. So the only game out there is volume. You have to keep on increasing the volume. As you keep on increasing the volume, even multiplied by a low margin, the money comes out. I mean, you are able to, helps you to bear the cost of the entire operation, the plants, the depots and the people and whatever else that you do in your organization. So that's one side of the business, and the whole push for everybody in all industries, and more so in dairy, would be to look for value-added products where I can offer you something for which you are ready to pay a better price and give me a better margin. And, you know, we have a term called gross margin. I'm sure you learn in your colleges. I mean, if the gross margins are in the range of 25, 30, 35% in branded products. And in non-branded, it will go to 10, 11. I mean, depends on what kind of a market space you're on, what is the supply-demand equation out there. That's how it runs. So the whole goal is to keep on launching and trying new products in this space where value add can be focused upon. So now, even before I start with the milk part of it, let me talk a little bit to Coca-Cola, because 23 years in Coca-Cola. And even companies like Coca-Cola at time, and we were in India, we came in 92-93 that time. And you can sometimes, with a branded product, get into a value game with competition. And you can enter into a space where you start selling very high volumes at lower price. So you must have heard about this 5 rupee thanda matlab Coca-Cola and 5 rupees you know, that was a you would be pretty young that time, so we guys were like selling the stuff for 5 rupees, and it all became a super competitive space. Suddenly the prices fell, the margins fell. Now the moment the margin falls, the first thing that disappears from the table is marketing. And you know, we give coolers. You've seen these red coolers of Coca-Cola in the market, and some of them are many of them are bolted outside the shop. They are to drive impulse. That is, they drive to drive volume, you know, and that costs money. That costs money to put that big cooler there. It costs money to bolt it out there, and it costs money to market the brand. And then once you start to take low pricing, you start to get into this cycle where you are not investing behind the brand, and you are basically trying to drive on price and trying to attract the consumer on price. And all of us, our competitors, the competition with Pepsi, we were all in the same wine. And this went on for many years till we realized that we're not just getting out of the hole of ever making proper money in as a business. And we were expanding the consumer base, but not in a profitable way. And then later we said, okay, let's go back and increase the price. We increased the price. We went back and then put in the coolers, because the increased price means margin. The margin means you can buy these coolers, then you can do marketing, you can spend money on TV, you can do whatever is required, and you rebuild your business. And you go back and say that, I'm not going to go on price. I'm going to go on as a brand. And the term brand, fundamentally for a business head like me, where I've been largely a business head through my entire roles, it means only one thing to me. It gives you pricing ability. It gives you an ability to create a profitable business as a business as a whole, obviously meeting some consumer need, and the consumer should be willing to pay for that value. So we guys literally built back the business in the next one decade and invested very heavily behind coolers, behind marketing, and then we, you know, became, let's say, a branded business. And that cycle picks up. Once I call it a reverse cycle, when you go into the value play cycle, to a cycle where you're going to trying to sell a product. And I still remember the time when this decision was taken that we have to move away from 5 rupees. And it was decided just move away from, and we said the volume will tank 25%. And the company said, don't worry, do it, because that's the only way we will get out of this pricing game and really be able to. And then you'll have to work hard. You'll have to put the displays in the outlets. You'll have to put these coolers out and, you know, do a proper execution in the market and get the business. And that's what we did. And I think over the years, company came back and, you know, did it all right. And I think today it's a very profitable and a very sizable business in the country. And so that's one side of the story. So in Jersey also, in is the same drive. You know, how do you move from a commodity side only, which is a volume driven kind of a game, and on the other side try to move to value added part of the business. So in the last this company was previously run by four friends. They were promoters. They were the first people who came into the milk industry in the late 80s. They came into this business, and that time the government did not allow you to make this packet milk. It was only allowed for cooperatives and government companies to do that. And then finally they opened the market and said, okay, even private players can do. Before that, this company used to only make badam milk. Now this is a full, like 95% milk and just some sugar and some flavor of badam, but largely it's milk. If you were to drink milk at home, then you would have it like badam milk. So that's what they used to sell. And then slowly it went into milk because the government allowed that. And that's where the volume and the scale got built up with milk. Because once you move into a large volume commodity, you have to play very large in volume. You cannot play small in volume. And then on the side, you have to build your value-added portfolio. And then in about 2005, first round of Godrej investment happened, and the second round happened in 2016, when it became a, now it's fully owned by Godrej, not fully owned, majority owned by Godrej, and the earlier promoters also still have a stake. So my role, for example, is to report to the board, which is the earlier promoters and Godrej. And here now what happens is that in the last 4-5 years, I would say we have taken a serious push to build a value-added business. And we have looked at all opportunities, whether there are categories which are well established, like ghee. Ghee is a category. We make and sell Jersey ghee. And ghee can fetch a decent margin. It's a well-established category. A very sizable category, and we have been driving it pretty hard across from you know, driving the consumer. We built a 360 degree activation. These are terms you will learn as you'll experience in industry a lot, where when you want to really pick up a category and drive it to scale and bring it to a particular size, you must have seen probably the Smood launch, the small little Smood packet, which they have done, Parle has done, and sure they've done it in Ahmedabad also. So where you have to first pick up a category and decide what you're going to go after. And you, let's say I pick up ghee, and we picked up ghee about a year back, we picked it up in a big way. You have to first formulate your product. You have to make sure that your product meets the consumer palate. And that takes some, that's an R&D job. And that takes a lot of back and forth till you are very confident that a product quality is going to meet. And there are a lot of blind tests which you do with consumers, with housewives, and to make sure that you've got the right, I mean, the right audience. You have to pick the right audience. If you have a kids product, then you do it with the kids. Whatever you are launching, you have to make sure that the quality tallies. The second round starts with once you are confident about the product. I always tell my team, or don't start anything till you are very confident about what you're going with. And once you are feeling confident that this product is right, and now we have it looking good, the next part is probably the most difficult. This is probably the easier part of the whole game, to just land a product which meets the requirement. The biggest part is the marketing and the sales structure, which kicks in after that. And that's the one which requires a lot of planning and informing the consumer. Most important is how in India kind of a structure is, whether the general trade is a huge general trade market. Now what happens is, there are in Hyderabad itself, there'll be about 20,000 outlets which can probably keep ghee. And now how do you reach them? How do you display your product? How do you inform the consumer who walks in there, who has a plethora of brands lying there already? There's a lot of pressure in terms of stuff which is lying in the shop. You have to first convince the shopkeeper that, why don't you keep some of my stuff? Now they are very happy keeping stuff which is selling fast, which is historical, which is doing well. Why would they, you know? So you need to have your selling story as to why should you keep my stock? What's your profit story with me? Second, you need to have the communication at that shop so that the consumer who walks in can see. You'll have to run your promos, at least in the beginning, to get people to try out your product. In all the food products, the biggest thing is sampling. The more you will sample your product, and if you're confident about your quality, the more the chances that you will get a sticky consumer within some time. So there is a huge, humongous amount of sampling, which goes on all the time. And in that process, you will try cross promotions, you know, whether you can do it with an atta, because somebody takes an atta and tries your ghee. You can do with your milk itself, you know, you can give it every packet of milk, then you will be designed a sachet of ghee, a small sachet of ghee, which is then becomes a less cost from a sampling point of view. You don't have to do a very high price sampling, and that sachet goes with every curd. So the consumer tends to try out your ghee, and if they like your ghee, then the chances are that you'll get them back again. So that's one part of it, which is how to, you know, really engage and excite the consumer. The other side of it is the sales and distribution system. So I always tell all the young people who are getting out of colleges and coming to us, and I say, first job you should do is the sales job. Always spend, if you're a sales marketing person, I'm not talking about a finance person, but a sales and marketing person, I always say, first 2-3 years, don't sit in the office. You should not be in the office. You should be in the market. You should understand the sales and distribution of this country. And once you have understood how things move out here, how distributors work, how these PSRs, pilot sales reps, or the people who take the orders and outlets work. And if you have done all these jobs yourself directly, if you have worked for 6 months, 1 year doing these jobs in the sun, as they say, in the hot sun, and learned what kind of question answers come to all what you're trying to do, that is a very, very essential part. I really do not entertain anybody straight into the marketing department without having gone through the grind, as I say, at least 2-3 years of giving results on the ground and being able to manage the show with all the complexities which exist in the sales side of the business. Because once you come into the marketing cell, you have to understand what goes on there. Otherwise, you will design programs which are meaningless to the trade, to the market, and it'll be just a waste of company money trying to, you know, run things which nobody can understand in the ground. So I think that's what we do. And here also, we take, you know, management trainees, and we put them first 3 months, at least 3 years, sorry, two to three years minimum in the field, and then they can always come back to marketing or any other function. So in short, the distribution system in India is, it's got its own complexities. And you need to understand what is a distributor, what is the PSR, the pilot sales rep, how many outlets he covers in the beat, what kind of, what is called right execution daily. And that has been my biggest learning in my journey in Coca-Cola. That company has perfected to a large extent the mechanism of execution in millions of outlets. How to reach every small village, how to reach every small shop and to display your product, how to get the cooler and how to put the cooler not in any shop. Putting a cooler is one thing, putting a cooler just outside the shop where the product is visible is a job. And you're talking to maybe 40,000 outlets in Hyderabad. You're not talking to, that's just Hyderabad. So you can see the size and scale of that distribution and the way they're trying to drive impulse through the structure. So in short, that's the work which goes on in building a brand. It's just not the product and the quality. And the second part is the marketing and the distribution piece, which all has to fall into place. And if you get all these pieces together, the last part, which I always say, is the energy of the team. You know, you all will be leaders in business and industry. It's not just about the conceptual knowledge of what you're trying to do. That is just one part of the story. I really look for people who can take the team along and get them engaged and really motivated, you know, to get people to work at the 40, 45 degree centigrade temperature outside, to be charged about what they're doing. You need leaders who can carry them, whom they can believe in, who work with them shoulder to shoulder. So I think that is another big important part where you build programs which can excite the entire sales team. And there are a large number of teams in every company because of this width of distribution. I talked about 20,000, 30,000, 40,000 output, depends on your distribution. In a place like Hyderabad itself, I'm just talking about one city, you will have 50, 100 PSRs, so many sales executives and so many, you know, ASMs who will be running the show. All the people need to be excited and charged about what they're doing. If they want to really execute to a brand and bring it to the market, and so they need that energy, and that's the energy which the structure provides. And then you get, you know, the piece right, and then you can be sure that if you put all these elements into place, you will be able to land something like a brand on the ground. So that's one part, and maybe I talk more on the final part, as I call it, when we launch a brand and things. But the other part of it is the first part, which is getting the right consumer insight. So that is the marketing part, I call it. Getting the right consumer insight, understanding what need are you fulfilling of the consumer. And, you know, I'll give you an example. There are two types of products I said. One, where are well-established categories, like milk, curd. You don't need to explain to consumers what this is and when to have it. And then there are those categories where the consumers don't know. And the fact of the matter is, a product like Coca-Cola today, actually there's no specific occasion for you to have Coca-Cola. I mean, you're pretty much, you can have it anytime, the way many people would look at it. And the other part is that, how do you create an occasion where a consumer is supposed to have or feels like having a Coke always? Think about when you have a pizza or a burger, the chances are that you will want to have a Coke with it. But you have dinner every day, you have lunch every day. Now, ideal for us as a brand, Coca-Cola, would be that if you can get into a habit of having your dinner with Coke or lunch with Coke, which is very far from the Indian mindset yet. But if I go abroad, if I go to the US, the UK, and, you know, most of Europe, people have Coke with their lunch, their dinner, and that's why you have very high per capita there. The point is that the company has created and been able to create the relevance of the brand in that equation. In which occasion are you targeting, and how are you going about, you know, communicating to the consumer again and again, so that the person gets it in his head that this is the time I need to have it. You know, this is the fact that today, whenever you have a pizza or a burger and you feel like having a Coke, and I'm sure it's true for all of you, it's simply because of the item which you're having, that's why you're having it. A large part of it is marketing. A large part of it is what you've seen a lot and then sort of imbibed it without, and subconsciously it's become part of your diet. A very large part of it is how many times you have it. The story goes that if you make a person have in an occasion seven times the same thing in a, you know, with that occasion, you know, have your biryani and have your Coke. You do this seven times, the chances are that the person will the next time naturally do that. So I remember long years ago in Paradise Biryani, for one whole year, we gave a 5 rupee thumbs up with every biryani for one whole year free. Like, you have a biryani, you have a, you know, that's just how you set up the consumer connect in your mind, that, you know, have this and have this. So, I mean, those are the various techniques and thoughts. So I think beyond that, so what I'll do is I'll just now summarize whatever I've said a lot, and I've tried my best to give my real life experience to you in whichever way I can. And I've got one video which I can probably share with you, which is with Cream for Creamline, where we had this thick shake, which we had launched as part of this value added drive. And, you know, it's a matter of chance when I saw that video and I felt that this is probably the right audience. We will get something to learn from that and how we went about the thick shake. It gives you the entire journey from the consumer insight to how we went about launching it. So I think it's a small video. Maybe I'll play that, and then post which I think I'll open it up for the questions from your side. Let me just play this.
At Creamline Dairy, majority of the business comes from milk. We decided to increase the value-added product saliency from 25% to 40%. Under value-added products, milk drinks category is one of the fastest.
I just wanted to check, you guys can hear, right?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, okay.
Product saliency from 25% to 40%. Under value-added products, milk drinks category is one of the fastest growing. Hence, we decided to strengthen our presence in milk drinks. We interviewed many mothers at Hyderabad and Chennai and understood that kids don't like milk and end up eating unhealthy snacks. Mothers are concerned about their child's health. We found an opportunity to fill this need gap. Hence, we launched Milkshake. Having understood the competitive landscape, a thorough research was conducted to ensure we launch a winner product. Consumer research suggested that thicker the milkshake, healthier it is. We carried out blind tests to benchmark our product both in terms of thickness and taste with leading competitive brands, and we zeroed in on the winning product recipe. Jersey Thick Shake connotes milkshake that's very thick, hence healthy and tasty. Several packaging options were evaluated through simulated shelf test, and the best pack design was chosen. This was the first time Godrej logo appeared on a jersey pack. We developed four different concepts and tested among mothers to arrive at the most appropriate brand narrative. The four concepts being: Concept 1, Jersey Thick Shake for growth and development. Concept 2, Jersey Thick Shake as a hunger buster. Concept 3, Jersey Thick Shake as a healthy snack buddy. Concept 4, Jersey Thick Shake as a healthy refresher. In all the centers, Jersey Thick Shake as a healthy snack buddy was well received. Two alternative routes were tested with mothers and kids through Naramatics to understand the best route to communicate Jersey Thick Shake as healthy snack buddy. Naramatic 1, Sammy and Sandy. Naramatic 2, Protest. Sammy and Sandy's script scored high in the research on several parameters, which include likability, appeal, comprehension, persuasion, and resonance. 360-degree communication was developed based on this narrative.
Mommy! Akali!
Hey, it's snack time.
Hi, Sandy.
Hi.
Surprise! Idigo, mi kotta snack buddy, Jersey Thick Shake.
Nenu chocolate.
Banana fee.
Strawberry.
Hey, can I do my best buddies?
Buddy, 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 buddy.
So yummy. సో థిక్ ఇంకా చాలా హెల్దీ
100% స్వచ్ఛమైన పాలతో తయారు చేయబడింది జెర్సీ థిక్ షేక్ ఇప్పుడు స్నాక్ సమయం అయ్యింది ఆరోగ్యవంతం జెర్సీ తల్లి ప్రేమ తర్వాత అత్యుత్తమమైనది
The launch of Jersey Thick Shake was announced via a press conference in April 2018. As a follow-up to the launch, three high-impact initiatives were carried out. Product sampling was carried out at modern trade outlets. Healthy snacking ideas workshop by celebrity chef Amrita Raichand. School of Health program sampled the product to 30,000 kids across Hyderabad, Chennai and Bangalore. The result, initial offtake per outlet was 3 times the target. Jersey Thick Shakes helped Jersey gain share in milk drinks. In 3 years, our target is to achieve more than 100 crore rupees sales. Body, 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 body. Body, body, body,
body, body. Thank you very much. So I think that's that. So I just summarize what I just said, and I always, you know, one thing which you will see what McKinsey teaches us: always start with what you wanted to say, then you say and you describe and show what you had to show, and then you conclude with what you wanted, you know, exactly repeat, which is your role as people where as you step into the business, and if you are especially in the sales and marketing, would be to really you know, understand the consumer and land brands which give you pricing ability. I think that's the core of this whole message, and creativity is the key out there. Creativity is the key out there, and every company is looking for people with that kind of a mindset, that kind of a drive, who can bring these you know, ideas to light. So thank you very much, and I open it for questions.
Thank you so much, sir. I'm sure the participants must have gained more knowledge on this topic. The floor is now open for questions. I request the participants to type the questions in the chat box.
Mr. Suri, would you like to pick up your question yourself, or would you like Ritika to
just open this? Where is the chat box here? Participant layout. This side is this? No, the chat.
It's on the right hand side. Participants, and next to that is chat.
Oh, this is chat. Got it.
Yeah,
got it. Oh, very good question. I think so. I think it's top of mind for everybody. So let me just start with the first question which has come here. I think one question has come, right? So how has COVID-19 affected the dairy industry? Furthermore, has COVID-19 caused a shift in customer dairy product purchasing habits? COVID-19 has affected us in a big way. On two sides, and when I say the milk side and the value-added side. See, if you look at all our value-added products, which was things like milk drinks and thick shakes and everything, they really go up in sales in summers. They are a little summer-oriented products. We have lassi, we have buttermilk, you know, all our summer products. And two seasons, I mean, it's surprisingly, COVID comes precisely in April. And March ending April, and last the whole of the season, so which is April, May, June. So we even sell ice cream, by the way. We have ice cream, Jersey ice cream. So you can imagine products like these have had a massive impact for last 2 years in being able to sell these products, because at the right time the market shuts down, everything shuts down. So that's one side of the story. The other side is milk. Now milk relatively is more resilient because everybody has milk, and at least the home consumption continues. So the home consumption part of our business continues more or less very similar. And we were probably one of the essential industries, which was allowed to function even on March 23rd last year. So our plants never shut down even for a single shift. The business and the work went on through the entire period, because it was after all milk, and our job was to supply milk. There was a lot of risk to our people. our sales teams and our manufacturing teams, the distribution logistics teams, even the time of the second COVID April, and obviously the first when there was a lot of fear around COVID. But our system kept working. And I mean, hats off to our teams here, which took all the risk and didn't stop the business even for a single day or a single shift. And we were able to distribute milk the next day morning to all the houses without break. So that's the first. But then what happens is in milk is that there's another industry called Horeca, the hotel restaurants, even all these IT parks and all, they all shut down. And all the marriages and all the get-togethers shut down, and milk goes everywhere. So I think that's the place where we experienced a loss. So we all have experienced a loss, but a little lesser on milk side, a big one on the value-added part of it. And has it shifted consumer dairy product purchasing habits? Yes, it has shifted, especially we are seeing e-com in a big rise. So my e-com business is, e-commerce business is doubling, without too much of effort too. Ghee is selling like crazy through e-com. Many things which were selling from shops have started to sell through e-com. And that's a big change, Flipkart, Amazon. So a lot of business is shifting towards that. And surprisingly, and another interesting insight, once the lockdown is very, very firm, then it goes up faster. And then once the lockdown opens, there's a slight dip in the e-com always. So, you know, the consumer is also changing its and going about and going back to the shops a little bit. But largely, I think e-com is the big change which has happened for the whole country. I think they're not going away. And a large part of the business will occur through that. With increasing trends towards globalization, quality standards of milk and milk products cannot stay at variance with international market standards. Even with Indian society in a more steady towards self-reliance, it lacks necessary cold chain facilities and a proper interest to provide to procure quality milk from producers. How does Creamland work to remove these barriers? So India is a very large fresh milk market. If you go to many of the markets outside, people are taking UHT milk. You heat the milk to such a level that it lasts for longer. I mean, they still take milk, but it's a, so we are probably the ones who take fresh milk. I mean, the milk which you get in that packet in your house in the morning is something which was literally taken from the cow a day before. It is landing to your doorstep. So it's really fresh. The supply chain is a very tight supply chain, I would say. From the chilling center, yes, up to the chilling center, it is in a insulated vehicle. And then from there, it is in a chilled environment till it lands to the plant. And milk, the only thing is that if the temperature is high, the bacteria start to form. And, you know, that's why you have to keep it chilled. As long as chilled, it's okay. And one day is fresh milk. And the moment it hits our plant, it is pasteurized, which is same as, you know, the boiling which you do at the house, which you boil the milk and kill the, or you don't have the bacteria in it. And then, so I would say, do I say that the Indian milk market, the consumer is interested in fresh milk? They don't like the other too processed milk. And it is quite untouched milk which reaches your house, and with a very little limited amount of period when it is outside in room temperature. So to that extent, I'm saying, is our cold chain, we're going to keep improving it, and it gets better every time. We have all the insulated vehicles moving from the plant to the market. But in the shop, for example, in the retail shop, a person may keep it outside and not in the fridge. Now that can happen. But then it has got sufficient shelf stability that it can stay for some time and before it lands to your house, and it's normally consumed in one day. All the cycle on milk finishes in 2 days flat, maximum 3 days is finished. So the dairy being under the category of perishable goods, the advent of COVID-19 would have impacted the workforce available for maintaining the supply chain. So how was that managed for the organization? This I already talked to some time back. And I must say hats off to this team here. I remember a time this April, you all know how tough it had become. I'm sure everybody lost somebody or the other well known to them. And in this time, my plant did not shut down for even a second, the plant, the trucks, the distribution system was functioning, and it is allowed by the government. The government wants us to function. And we also took it on ourselves that we cannot, you know, let the consumer down. I mean, the person who's locked up at home, they should be able to get their milk at the end of the day. That's the bare minimum we can do. So I think that's what kept us going. And it is something which I really find, because I come from Coca-Cola and then I come and see how we worked here and what kind of situation we worked here. And that really humbled me, and it'll humble anybody once you see that happening. And there were people who had COVID, and you know, that was also going on in parallel with all the people who were working. And that was also going on in parallel with all the, but obviously we took care of all COVID precautions as you would, you know, think about any Godrej kind of a company would do. But still you can't prevent cases we have. We have lost people, by the way. We have lost people from within the organization in this process. So next is one of the challenges of CDPL has been introduction of foreign products in market. How is the company planning to counter this challenge? I would say a very small number. Very, very small. I would say foreign products, maybe you mean milk drinks and things coming from outside, very highly priced. I mean, the Indian consumer, like I said, is very value conscious. Anything beyond 20, our milkshake, which is 180 ml plastic bottle, I mean, it's for 25 rupees in all markets. So, you know, you go to a little bit higher in price, you are talking to a very small number of consumers in the country. So to that extent, we don't see that as a major challenge, frankly, foreign products coming in. Some milk producers produce local cow milk, such as Gir, Shahi, yes, very right, at a much higher rate. Very good question. And that's this whole thing, good question, I think. They operate on low volume too. If someone is looking to start selling, what would you suggest to consider first? So good, excellent question. I was thinking of covering that point, because when I was talking about how to convert a commodity into a brand, now this is the way to do it. The rate of 15, that kind of range. You want to sell it at 100 rupees a liter. Now, what you do is you have to provide value to the consumer. Now, for example, Gir cow, we did a study and we found that most consumers don't relate to Gir cow. Now, you will get such a small volume that you won't be able to make it. But when I talk about farm fresh, I'm sure you would have a farm fresh milk in bottles, not in these packets, in these glass bottles. And if you get this farm fresh milk, so that is one of the ideas. And there is a company which is done pretty well. Sids Farms has done a pretty good job here, I would say. And you know, we are also thinking of some farm fresh milk, which I can give you the milk in the most pristine fashion from a cow farm, ideally near my plant, to you in an absolutely fresh next day morning kind of situation, untouched, absolutely untouched in every sense. And that is what we are going to attempt to do. And then you can charge 100 rupees. That's the whole game of branding. But the biggest thing is not whether I can get this farm fresh or a product like that. The question is, how will I communicate to you and convince you that what this is and why you should pay 100 rupees a liter for it? That is the biggest job. You know, you can launch, there are a lot of companies which launch products like this. And then they get lost because the consumer doesn't understand the proposition. You are unable to communicate to the consumer. Sometimes you're not able to put the supply chain or the volume, like you rightly say, so low. So there are companies which have done, I think Pride of Cows on that side, they have also done something like that. And it is a whole game of marketing, distribution, logistics, and product design. How do you get the story across to the consumer to make it land? That you can actually get it to about 3,000, 4,000 liters per day kind of a business, and then it becomes viable. The livestock service, especially dairy, has the potential to play a larger role in the government goal for doubling. Okay, how can we achieve this goal, keeping in mind that the future of dairy in India is highly reliant on modernizing? Okay, now the difference between what you find in dairy in India and abroad. If you go in many of these developed countries, you have these huge farms, you know, 3,000 cow farm, 5,000 cow farm. Everything is there as a consolidation. In India, there are small farmers. They do their farming and they also have some 5-10 cows, 3 cows, 5 cows, 6 cows. So when I say I get my milk from 1.5 lakh farmers, because they're small farmers, and that is the way the supply chain is built. Now we in India would want it's an important source of livelihood for the farmer. Now versus a big farm, you know, where then the farm, what will the farmer do is the other side. So the Indian government, and largely we are also promoting the structure of, even if it is small farmer, we have a system of consolidating the milk coming from a village level and then moving to our chilling centers, because we wish to make sure that the small farmer also, it's an important source of income for the small farmer, which we wish to retain for them. So I think that's the goal there, and the farmer's income has to be developed. Fully agree. So we have something called Maxi Milk. Godrej has another company, it's in Nasik, where we are experimenting with genetics, where the cows which can give more milk and sort of helping the farmers. So we are already having an experiment in Madanpally, which is in Andhra itself, where we are giving them these cows so that they can see the milk, how much it produces, and then they can invest in a cow which gives 30 liters a day, whereas another cow gives only 7 to 8 liters a day. So there is this work going on where we are trying to make their farmer income more, the whole structure more viable for the farmer, where the volume of milk per cow can go up, and that is but still in a structure where there are many farmers, not in a structure which is a consolidated big farm structure, because we generally believe that this is an important source of livelihood which we want to maintain for the farmer. I think one thing we'll have to take care is that the time is about 3:15 and there are a lot of questions, and this is the young fresh minds with a lot of questions, and maybe I can just keep reading and going. We have time till about 3:30, ready over 5 minutes for the closing, 4 minutes for the closing. That's all that.
Yes, sir. So you can choose choose amongst the questions and answer two or three questions maybe.
Yes, how is Criminal working towards the betterment of healthcare? So we run a lot of veterinary camps. We give a lot of free, this part of our CSR activities, which happens in a massive scale. I have a whole department which sits and works with the farmer trying to improve animal health, and which ultimately helps their income and helps the whole structure run very well. So major problem in uninformed farmers. I don't know whether we are not working directly on farmer literacy, but let me tell you, the farmers are pretty well informed. I mean, I have met a lot of farmers now in the last 1.5 years. They know their part of the world pretty well. Now, the question is, there are new techniques coming up. Like I just talked about this Maxi Milk cows, a cow which can give 30 liters of milk, and how what kind of food to give them. One important part about cattle is what kind of food that the cattle is fed, so that they get the right output and they're also very healthy. Now, if you just leave them to graze or you don't have the right food going in, then the output is also not that good. So we have an organization, Animal Feed Organization. We are leaders as Godrej Agrovet, an animal feed, and we also supply feed. So through my milk chilling centers and all that, we train the farmers about this animal feed and we also sell it. So we get it and we keep it there. So somebody who comes to give his milk, we also sell them the cattle feed and explain the benefits of giving the right food to the cattle. So that's what we do there. You mentioned about thumbs up being paired up with
a brand. Mr. Suri, I also have one question.
Sure. Okay, maybe I'll just do this one and then you can pick that up. And you mentioned thumbs up being paired with burger, pizza, biryani, making consumer trend. In the beginning, how do the pitch $7 the dominance? Very good question. So let me tell you, the amount we struggled with Thumbs Up and Coca-Cola was not funny. We wasted one decade. The first decade, I call it, we wasted on what to do with. We said we'll shut down Thumbs Up. You won't believe this. The internal thinking was that we can't have two colas. It confused the consumer. We should have Coca-Cola, and we can't do two times marketing in the TV and all that stuff. So we should slowly move things to Coca-Cola. So this went on for some time. And then we realized that the consumer doesn't seem to get it. They like thumbs up. So I still remember one CEO who came and he said, look, guys, if somebody likes thumbs up and that's working for them, why go and convince somebody and say, why don't you have Coke? I mean, we are happy. That's also a brand. That's also our brand. So I know you are in Gujarat, for example, it's like complete thumbs up. I know. And for Andhra, complete thumbs up. Surprisingly, Punjab and Delhi is complete Coca-Cola. So the, you know, very low thumbs up. So then we said, okay, then we got into the next phase. We said, doesn't matter. Take what you want. We're going to market both. We're going to distribute both, everything, both. And it works. So, but once you go to a McDonald's or a Domino's, you know, these kind of guys are international key accounts. They are very well managed straight from Atlanta downwards. And this is like, you know, they'll only have Coke if you notice. They won't have thumbs up largely. They may have, I'm not sure. You see, now we have become more localized. So it's possible by now they realize that if you want thumbs up there, they will put thumbs up also there. But Coke will definitely be there in a McDonald's, for example. So I think now we are saying we have two colas and both the colas, you know, take whatever you want. I mean, wherever we go, we are okay with them. And they're also fine. They also want consumers and relevant stuff for the consumers. So, yes, Dr. Subir.
Yeah, I have one soft question. Right. Being an organization person, look, yeah. You have worked in different kind of with different kind of teams. Mm-hmm. All right. One international, the biggest brand in the world, mm-hmm. the Coke, and that is one kind of a setup. You have also, and with one kind of culture. You've also worked in Nigeria with a different kind of culture. You've also worked in the bottling plant, which also I'm sure has a different kind of culture. And now you're working in a domestic MNC.
Mm.
How do you see this cultural, the cultural differences across? Because a lot of my young friends are going to get out from their comfort zone and will probably have to work through different organizations to in pursuit of their career aspirations. What is your message to them, sir?
So, yeah, I think that's a very interesting question. And it's been a range of kind of organizations. And when I look at it from an Indian kind of a environment, probably the biggest change which happens is the Indian environment and Nigeria environment. I mean, first of all, I would really suggest people in the room, while you build your careers, maybe you'll take it up in India or abroad, whatever, learn, go cross-cultural. It teaches you a lot. It teaches you a lot about what you thought was standard. I mean, this is the way things are done, or this is the way they should be done. And then you realize that my biggest learning, for example, between a world of Coca-Cola India and a Coca-Cola Nigeria. In India, we are like true Indians. You know, we are very flexible with our timings and the way we function. And when I went to Nigeria, everything is so structured. I mean, you know, at least Coca-Cola worldwide, I'm not talking the country, Nigeria is very structured, but I'm just saying the way the world works on an international environment, especially when you have Greeks, Indians, and from Nigerians and different parts of the world, you know, participating in a particular place. The biggest thing you learn is the system and process by which it works and how you manage these different cultural nuances, let's put it this way. And I think that's the learning which only you get once you experience. I mean, it's impossible to, you know, explain to you over a talk, but I can say it's something which people should do. And once you step out of this college, I only suggest to people one thing, roll up your sleeves, be ready to really dig deep into whatever you're doing. Don't leave anything to the surface. Whichever area you pick up, you can land up into MNC, you can land up into Indian domestic, whichever way you want to land up. We have an attitude which is always says, I'm ready to do whatever you want me to do. I'm ready to try it out. I'm ready to attempt and learn about it. So I think that is, if I look at today, when I have been recruiting now for so many years now, and I see what is that single indicator of a person and how they sort of groom up over time, is this attitude, how much they are willing to do, willing to try new things, willing to always bubbling with idea, always bubbling with energy and ability to contribute and not getting lost in politics. All organizations have politics. There is no organization I've been to without politics. And, you know, this, like, you can take it as a given. How you're able to move your eyes away from that little messy political world and move it towards how you can contribute to and what you could do in that structure. I think that keeps people true to their and really make people grow. I have recruited people like management training like yourself who have landed to leadership positions in so many years. And so, you know, you can see this whole trend and see how people are, what kind of people they are, and what makes true leaders, you know, stand out. I don't know whether I answered your question. It's a pretty wide question.
Yes, you have. Thank you very much.
Okay. All right.
Yeah. So,
yes. I would now like to invite Dr. Sapna Parashar, faculty in the area of marketing and coordinator, Silver Jubilee Celebration, to extend the vote of thanks to our esteemed speaker.
Sapna is having a problem, it seems.
Sir, good afternoon all.
Yeah.
Sir, am I audible?
Yeah.
Yes.
Good afternoon all. On behalf of IMNU and Silver Jubilee Committee, I extend my deep appreciation to Mr. Suri, CEO Creamline Dairy Products, for sparing his valuable time for Silver Jubilee CEO Lecture Series. Sir, we admire your powerful thoughts on steps of building strong brands. Of course, you have given such a creative examples, right, from dairy to soft drinks with a lot of consumer insights. Consumer connect with the brand, which is very essential. And of course, very important for our student is relevance of sales team. At the same time, motivating them to start right from the field, which is very essential for their career. Really, sir, it is really a very powerful message to them. We extend our sincere thanks to Director General, Nirma University, Dr. Anoop Singh, for inspiring presence and encouragement. We remain in debt to Dr. Verma, Director, IMNU, for providing direction and support always. We are thankful to my faculty colleagues, CRC team, and administrative staff for continuous support in this endeavor. Thank you all and have a great evening. Thank you so much, sir, once again. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank